how we're going to end up. We're going to start there. John chapter 3, Nicodemus comes to see Jesus. And he says to him, you must be born again. And of course, John says, well, how can I be born again? I can't go back into my mother's womb. Yeshua said, you have to be born of water and the Spirit. If you don't do that, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. But then we get down to verse 16, and Jesus makes this statement. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The one who believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe has been condemned already, because he has not put his trust in the name of the one and only Ben Elohim, the Son of God. So, did Yeshua ever say, Jesus ever say to Nicodemus, okay, here's the deal, Nicodemus. If you want to believe in me, you got to pray a prayer, and you got to ask God to forgive you of your sins, and you got to ask me to come into your life. Did he ever say that? No. All he said was, you got to believe. You have to believe. In fact, I was thinking, well, maybe he said we should pray to receive the Holy Spirit, but he didn't even say that. So, we're not supposed to pray, we're supposed to believe. We're just supposed to believe. Believe in him. And he says to Nicodemus, you got to be born again. Well, how am I born again? You believe. That's how you're born again. You believe. You believe. Well, let's go to John chapter 17. Because this is where the revelation came in. I'll be honest with you, I've never heard a sermon preached on this passage of Scripture. Never. In my whole life, growing up in church and being in church almost every Sunday, I have never heard a preacher preach. Now, you might have, and some of you preachers might have preached it, but I have never heard a sermon preached on this revelation that God gave to me. Never. So, let's go to John chapter 17, verse 1. Yeshua spoke these things. Well, let me just back up for a second. John gives us words that Yeshua spoke, Jesus spoke, to the disciples after they had had communion. After the one who betrayed him left. After he had gone, he's gone. And so John tells us that Jesus said all of these things to the disciples. We don't know if they were sitting in the room or they were walking to where they were going to go pray. We don't know where he was when he said it, but he said all of these things. And then in chapter 17, it says that Jesus looks up to heaven and begins to pray. So, he prays. Yeshua spoke these things. Then lifting up his eyes to heaven, he said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so the Son may glorify you. Even as you gave him authority over all flesh, so may he give eternal life to all those you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Yeshua the Messiah, the one you sent.
Amen.
I read those words and I said, what? This is eternal life. This is eternal life, that you may know the only true God. That's eternal life. That you may know the only true God. What? We read that and we looked at each other and we said, what? What is he saying? You know, and so that's what I'm saying. It's been months ago, and I've thought about it, and I've prayed about it, and I've meditated on it. This is eternal life, that you may know the only true God. The only true God. Now again, just listen. He didn't say, this is eternal life, that you pray to receive salvation. No. This is eternal life, that you may know. Know. Now that Greek word know is ginosko. And it's actually a subjunctive, present subjunctive tense, and so it's in that form. But here's the thing that I want you to understand. It's a present tense, and in the Greek, what the present tense means is you got to keep on doing it. It just keeps on going. You keep on knowing. And so it could be translated, you keep on knowing the one true God. You keep on knowing, because that's what it really means. You've got to keep on knowing. You've got to stick with it. You've got to stay with it. You've got to know the one true God. You've got to know him. Well, okay, Lord, I know you. I know you. So that means I've got eternal life. See, if we base eternal life on a prayer that we prayed, Satan comes along and says, God didn't hear you when you prayed. You don't have eternal life. See, I think the prayer to pray it in was a tool of the enemy so he can come along to us and tell us we ain't got it. Never in the scripture does it say to pray to receive Jesus. It says to believe. It says believe. It says trust. And so people come and they say they want to receive Jesus, and we say, okay, let's pray a prayer. No, believe. Just believe that he came. If I come forward and I say, I believe that he came, I'm saved. I'm born again. That's all it takes. I need to believe. I need to trust. Now, let's go to Acts. The reason we're going there is because I want to show you something else out of this whole thing. Go to Acts chapter 2. Peter is preaching on the day of Pentecost. Acts chapter 2. And in verse 37 it says, now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the emissaries, fellow brethren, what shall we do? Peter said to them, repent. What does repent mean? Repent doesn't even mean I pray. Repent means I change my mind. Repent means I change the way I'm thinking. I used to think that he wasn't God. Now I believe that he is God. I repent of the way I think. I repent. I think I can live life my own way, the way I want to live it. And then I repent. I change the way I'm thinking, and I begin to understand I need to live life the way God wants me to live it. I need to live life the way Jesus wants me to live it. I repent. So I repent, and let each of you, let each of you be immersed in the name of Messiah Yeshua for the removal of your sins, and you will receive the gifts of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. For the promises for you and your children, and for many, and for all who are far away, as many as Adonai our God calls to himself. And that phrase, as many as are far away, doesn't mean far away in place, that they live a far away way. It's talking about far away in time. Far away in time. All that means, that includes us and includes everybody who's going to be born. All of us. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far away, as many as Adonai, our God, calls to himself. Wow. Okay, let's go back to John 17. We're going to believe that he is the only, that God is the only true God. Well, I know Rabbi Pastor Roy has spoken on this, but let's look at this. Matthew chapter 22. Verse 34. Matthew 22. Verse 34. But the Pharisees, when they heard that Yeshua had silenced the Sadducees, gathered together in one place. And testing him, one of them, a lawyer, asked, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the Torah?" And he said to him, "You shall love Adonai your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. The entire Torah and the prophets hang on these two commandments." Everything in the Torah, everything in the prophets hang on these two commandments. That's interesting. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. The passage actually starts out, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one." You shall love the Lord and love the Lord your God with all your heart, with your soul, and your mind. This is Deuteronomy chapter 6. So, what is the greatest commandment? Jesus was asked. And he said, "Love God, the Lord your God, with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind." That includes everything. Your heart, your emotions, everything. Your soul is actually the word that we would translate probably spirit, because it's psuche, spirit, and that's soul, and so probably with all your spirit, because the spirit is more in That's what the word, the Greek word means, spirit. But love God with all your heart, with all your spirit, and with all your mind. With your mind, with all your thinking. Now, he quoted Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy doesn't say mind, it says strength. But, you know, Yeshua's God. He can do whatever he wants to. He can quote it however he wants to quote it. So he changed it. He didn't say, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. Why did he do that? You ever heard of a book called The Battlefield of the Mind? Joyce Myers. I think he understood. I think he understood that it doesn't matter if you love him with all your strength, if your mind is taking you down paths that will never get you to God. If your mind is thinking things that are taking you off and away from God. So you got to love God with all your mind. Which means, when I have a thought that's taking me away from God, Paul says, I'm supposed to say, I take that thought captive to the obedience of Christ. And not think it. Not continue to let it go. And then in my mind, I begin to think about God. I think about him. I think about all he's done for me. I think about all the blessings he's given. I think about all the things that he has done and will continue to do. And because of all that, obviously, he deserves all of our love. And so I love him with thoughts that come out of my mind. Battle going on for this. It's not the battlefield of the spirit. It's not the battlefield of the heart. The book is the battlefield of the mind. Yeshua knew that was coming. So he says, love the Lord with all your mind. All your heart. That's down here. It's not up here. It's down here. All your heart. Everything that you are, love God. That's the greatest commandment. The greatest of all the commandments. But I thought the Ten Commandments. Well, the greatest commandment is love God. Love God. Notice it doesn't say, pray to God. It says, love God. Love God. And the second commandment is love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. And who's my neighbor? Jesus was asked, and he told the parable of the Good Samaritan. He got to the end of it, and he said, so who do you think is the best neighbor? And he said, the one who gave mercy. He said, you're exactly right. Go and do likewise. So the Good Samaritan is a good picture of us, to us about what the neighbor, who the neighbor is. The neighbor is not just the one that I like, it's the one that maybe doesn't fit with me. In other words, love. They will know that you are my disciple by the doctrine that you have. They will know you are my disciples by the knowledge that you have. They will know you are my disciple by the love that you have. And so we take that love. Give it out. to our neighbor. Whoever our neighbor is, we give it out. Some neighbors are close and some neighbors are distant. We give it out to whoever God puts in our path. We love it. This is eternal life, that you may know the only true God. There's only one God. And Jesus says then, and Yeshua the Messiah, the one you sent. It's interesting, and actually as you read commentators, they're talking about the fact that he's praying and he says, eternal life is this, that they may know the one and only true God and Yeshua the Messiah, the one you sent. He's talking about himself. He's praying about himself. And so some commentators looked at that and said, that's kind of strange. Why didn't he just say, me? You know, he's praying. Why didn't he just say, they got to believe in you, Father, and they got to believe in me? That would make more sense. But he's telling us something about himself. He's telling us something about eternity. We need to know God.
Yes.
The only true God. Only true God. And we need to know Yeshua the Messiah. God. See, he had emptied himself. And so he's praying, and he's praying to God, and he's saying, Yeshua the Messiah, because Yeshua the Messiah is God. One, they're one. He's God. But he had emptied himself, Paul says. He had emptied himself. And so as he prays, Father, Yeshua the Messiah, the one you sent. That's eternal life, to know him, to know God, the only true God, and to know Yeshua the Messiah, the one that God sent. That's eternal life. That's eternal life. So what does that mean? If that's eternal life, what does that mean? Again, the mind gets in the way because we think about eternity. I know we used to drive to Florida every year to go see my dad's sister and brother-in-law and my grandmother. So we'd go every summer, and we'd drive to Florida, and we'd drive through the night. So when we're sitting there in the back seat, looking out at the stars and all of that, thinking about eternity, and thinking about it, those stars are so far away that when the light gets to me, that star could already be burned out, and I would be there. And that would just kind of blow my mind. We'd have conversations about God, you know, and so I began thinking about that. Eternity. And live forever. And, you know, we think about gold streets, and Jesus said that he's going to go prepare a mansion for us, and all these things, and so, and we think about the mansions, and we think about all of that, but he just said eternal life is knowing God and Yeshua the Messiah. That's eternal life. To Eternal life is not about our mansion. Eternal life is about Him. Eternal life is not about anything we're going to have. The eternal life is about everything's going to go to Him. He deserves it all, and He's going to get it all. That's eternal life. We're going to spend eternity with Him. And when we're with Him, we're not going to be thinking about us. We're going to be thinking about Him. That's the only thing that's going to be in our minds, is Him. That's eternal life. And so really, if I'm thinking about Him right now, I'm already living eternal life. But we come here to worship, and we're worshiping Him, and we're knowing Him, we're already living in eternal life. Because then that's what eternal life is. It's knowing Him. It's knowing the one and only true God, knowing Yeshua, the Messiah. Wow. That's awesome. That is eternal life. We will live forever with Him. We will live forever worshiping Him. We will live forever doing whatever He tells us to do once we're there. But we're doing it all for Him. So that's why down here we need to do what He wants us to do. So we're ready.